Venerable Shantatmananda, Secretary Ramakrishna Mission Delhi, distinguished speakers on the stage, venerable monks, sisters and brothers, allow me to start with a short prayer of Saint Ignatius. Mukti amar, Icha amar, Manush amar, Sharon amar, Loho he Prahu, Loho amar Loho. Amar goti chalitoho tomar Icha moto, Tomar adesh korbo palon, Korbe jokon joto. Dao he tomar prem, Tomar ashirbad. I want to thank the Venerable Secretary of Ramakrishna Mission Delhi and all the organizing members of this Interfaith Meet for giving me this opportunity to participate and to share with you some of my reflections on Christian response to Swami Vivekananda's message of tolerance and harmony. The major contributions of Swamiji to the world community were his philosophy of religious universalism, his advocacy for religious harmony, and his exhortation to believers to assimilate the goodness embedded in different faith traditions. This he brought out in his historic speech at the Chicago Parliament of Religions in 1893, where he represented India and Hinduism. The Chicago Parliament was the decisive moment in his life and his ministry. It looked on him as a world religious leader. In simple language, religious universalism means that all religions are but different paths to reach the same goal, the Almighty. Therefore, they are true and equal as effective paths to lead their respective faithful people with diverse tastes and temperaments to the same goal. Swamiji pleaded for ending religious sectarianism, bigotry and fanaticism, and gave the clarion call for religious harmony. The overwhelming applause that he received from the audience for his speech was the confirmation that they were waiting for this message of harmony and cooperation rather than confrontation and competition between religions. Swamiji's message of harmony given at this World Religions and the introduction of the study of world religions as part of liberal arts in European universities by the end of the 19th century became part of a historic process, eventually ushering in a culture of religious pluralism in the Western world in the early part of the 20th century. For our part as Christians, I recall here that at the Second Vatican Council, held between 1962 and 65, the Catholic Church updated her approach towards contemporary world, marked by ethos of cultural and religious diversity. She declared her deep and abiding respect for other religions and chose the path of dialogue and collaboration with the people of goodwill for religious harmony and peace in the world. Christians today understand themselves as co-pilgrims with the followers of other faith traditions in pursuit of the divine mystery that transcends all religions and revelations. They believe, I quote, for all people form a single community. Their origin is one. For God made the whole human race to dwell over the entire face of the earth. Vatican Council's second document further states, the Catholic Church rejects nothing of what is true and holy in all religions. With sincere respect, she looks on those ways of conduct of life, those precepts and teaching, which though differing on many points from what she herself holds and teaches, yet not rarely reflect ray of that truth which enlightens all human beings. The Catholic Church advises her people that a way of life committed to interreligious dialogue and collaboration for building up a civilization of religious harmony and world peace implies that they esteem and share in the cultural and social life of their neighbors of different faith traditions. The Church recommends that Christians live in esteem, love for believers of other religions, share in their cultural and social life by various exchanges, enterprises of human living, and get to familiarity with their national and religious traditions. I think this is what Pope Francis conveyed to the world when on Holy Thursday in 2016, in a refugee camp near Rome, he washed the feet of 12 refugees from different faith traditions and nationalities, including 3 Muslims and a Hindu from India. He said in his homily, "You, we, and all of us of different religions, different cultures, but children of the same Father. We are brothers and we want to live in peace." The Pope's action certainly resonates with the ancient wisdom of our Holy Land. Again, in another place, Pope Francis reiterated it on the 13th January 2015 in his speech at the city of Colombo. And he said, I quote, "Whenever people listen to one another humbly and openly, their shared values and aspirations become all the more apparent. Diversity is no longer is seen as a threat, but a source of enrichment. The path to justice, reconciliation, and social harmony becomes all the more clearly seen." Pope John Paul II, in his apostolic exhortation addressed to the whole church in Asia, named as Ecclesia in Asia in 1999, he said, and I quote, "The advent of a new millennium offers a great opportunity for interreligious dialogue and for meetings with the leaders of the great world religions. Contact, dialogue, and cooperation with the followers of all religions are a task which the Second Vatican Council behooved to the whole church as a duty and a challenge." He pleaded for the same concern in his apostolic letter, beginning the new millennium. He wrote, "In the climate of increased cultural and religious pluralism, which is expected to mark the society of the new millennium, it is obvious that this dialogue will be especially important in establishing a sure basis for peace and harmony. Hence, interreligious dialogue in various forms has been part of the Catholic Church's service to humanity. The following are some of these forms of dialogue put into practice at various levels all over the world. Number one, a dialogue of discourse. This is a dialogue among scholars of different religious traditions on a constructively critical study of their scriptural texts, beliefs, theologies, myths, and histories of various traditions. And number two, dialogue of religious experience. This sort of dialogue is done between Christian monasteries and ashrams and such like centers of other religious communities where high level of trust and mutual respect are involved while sharing one's deepest aspects of faith experience. Number three, dialogue of action. This sort of dialogue takes place when believers of various religious traditions come together to address common social concerns. Number four, dialogue of life. This is a dialogue which happens between believers of different faith traditions in the marketplace, in the offices, factories, and workplaces of their daily life. Dialogue of celebrations. It is a part of dialogue of life based on sacred places and times in the civil society. This is a dialogue that takes place when believers of different faith tradition come together to celebrate common festivals of different religions as often as we do in Kolkata. Dialogue in academia. This is a kind of dialogue that we have introduced in many of our schools, colleges, and universities, where we teach the basic principles of major religions of the world as a part of our academic contribution to culture, harmony, peace among communities of different faiths. Dear brothers and sisters, we are challenged then to go beyond the confines of tolerance by showing respect to all individuals and communities, because everyone desires and deserves to be valued according to his or her innate dignity as a human person. We have a lot more to do, not alone, but as a community. Together as believers, as men and women, for the cause of human well-being. In this regard, I believe we share a lot of common values and concerns of religious harmony and social amity with the members of the Ramakrishna order of monks, the neo-Vedantic tradition of this ancient land of ours, who carry forward the great legacy of Swami Vivekananda to the world community. With divine blessings, I believe all is possible for us as long as the eternal master abides in our midst. Thank you very much, and God bless you.